Hey everyone, so now we are starting with the microservices cross-cutting concerns. And we are going to see some of the concepts under this cross-cutting concerns, which are very important when we are developing individual microservices. So first of that, we are going to see the circuit breaker. And circuit breaker also, we say that fault tolerant. Fault tolerant means if we have developed microservices, we have many microservices in our application, right? And we cannot prevent the errors to happen, exceptions to happen. They are definitely going to come no matter how much 100% and all those errors that all those testing that we have done. So the point here is that how effectively, how gracefully I can handle those errors. So circuit breaker is all about those. So how we can handle the errors that are coming gracefully, let the request end properly, right? So let me go ahead and explain you all about this circuit breaker and use cases all about it. So first we are going to understand the problem statement. So why do we need circuit breaker? So these are the individual services that I'm taking for an example here. And this is the client that it has requested something with the order service. Order service is subsequently going to call the product service. Product service is going to make call to the pricing service. Pricing service is going to make, after completing everything, every step here. So finally, order service, this call is not going to happen here. So I'm just trying to make it more realistic. After getting the response from these with all the pricing information, order service is going to make call to the payment service. And payment service, before processing the payment, it is going to make the fraud check with the user, the cards and all those entries that they are having. Imagine this fraud service had some problems, like it can be network issue, it can be code issue, and there can be any logical error, and there can be timeout error from this fraud service to come to payment service. So what is going to happen here? So that if we have not handled that properly, it is going to come to payment service, and payment service is going to burst drastically, and the same burst and same fume is going to come to order service here. Order service is going to take the same burst here, and there is no proper handling here, and the same thing is going to come to the client. And now client is very furious that what kind of exception and all these things that we are getting. So under distributed system, when we are in microservices architecture, everything that is being generated by the application, we should consider that as events. We should consider those as data. So errors logging that it is generating is very important. So one thing is must, that they are going to come anyway, that how much testing you have done doesn't matter. So they are going to come, so you cannot ignore that. It's better you plan for that. Anytime any error is coming, so you log that properly, you handle that properly, do some mechanism so that that exception, we can minimize the impact of that exception. Like if in real time scenario, if I can say that we cannot stop the natural disasters like earthquakes, tsunamis, floods, they are coming everywhere throughout the world. We cannot stop those. But when we know that they are coming, we can prepare for the them, and we can reduce the disaster that they are going to cause. Ultimately, they are going to cause the disaster, but if we are prepared, we can reduce that impact, whatever they are going to create. Same is applicable with our distributed architecture as well. If we are planned, if we have planned for that, we can reduce the impact of that one. So circuit breaker is all about that. So let's understand this. So this is the diagram. This is our client that we have. This is the circuit breaker, and this is the third party call. So imagine we have payment service here. We have payment service here for the circuit breaker, and I have to implement circuit breaker on the payment service. So under payment service, I have to write a method. From the previous example, you know that payment service is going to make the fraud check call. The method where fraud check call is written here, which is calling the fraud check service here, I can wrap this call, this method one, under circuit breaker. So whatever going to happen this under this M1 method, circuit breaker is going to monitor those things. And anything wrong happens, then role of the circuit breaker comes into picture, and there are many things that I can do with this one. Let's understand the first flow that we have. Client has requested with something from the payment service. Here client is the order service that we have. circuit breaker, it is going to pass the call to the supplier, that is the fraud check service here, and here it has responded that bit properly. But in subsequent request, we have connection problem here. Due to connection problem, we are getting the timeout. So it is not responding at all, this fraud check service. And now circuit breaker can decide how to respond to client with that one. As this is the first problem, it is the first time that this problem is coming for the first request. So it can pass the same request timeout to the client. So that's okay. But in the subsequent call, it is also getting the timeout call. Again, it is going to respond with the timeout because it is the second request that it is coming. But for the subsequent request, it is going to trip this connection. The subsequent request, it is not going to call the third party service at all. It is going to return from the payment service itself to the client by this status that circuit is open. Circuit is open or any custom handling that I can do with this method that we have here. So as many times now client is going to call this payment service here, at this point it is not going to call the supplier service here. It is going to directly return from here. So there are different configuration that we can. So we cannot stop all the requests all the time from getting this one supply this fraud check service. We have to come up with the mechanism that self-healing. There in future there will be some mechanism when this service is up, it is going to respond to the circuit breaker, and this payment service circuit breaker implementation going to know that now this fraud check service is up, it is working properly. Now all the requests that are that were coming earlier will start going to this one, and it will start serving the request properly. So again, if any problem is coming under this call here, it is going to monitor that based on the threshold that we have configured, and it is going to monitor those call and respond accordingly. Now let me show you one more diagram with this circuit breaker, then it will be more clear. So there are different states of the circuit. Here this circuit keyword is very important here, because that circuit is now holding the call to the third party or any problematic call, any time consuming call that can happen is wrapped under that circuit breaker. That method that if we have, it is going something sensitive and time consuming, I have to be serious about it, and I can wrap this call under circuit breaker. So it is going to monitor that for all the errors and timeout things that is going to happen. Initially, the circuit is in closed state. These are the state of the circuits, and every request that it is making to the third party and all those things, everything is going fine. There is no problem. Success is happening. So it is always closed as many requests that it is coming here. And we have some threshold, right? Right under 1 minute, it is allowing that 5 requests can fail. So this is the just random number that I'm taking. Under 1 minute, if 5 requests are failing, there is no problem. It is going to assume that 5 requests can fail, no problem. So under 1 minute, if 5 requests are failing, circuit is still going to be in the closed state. But if in 1 minute there are 6 requests that is going to fail, then that state circuit breaker state is going to be in open state. When this circuit state is in open state, and any method that is trying to call this M1, it will not actually call this M1 here. Circuit breaker now respond to the with this state that circuit is open now. There will be fallback methods to report this one. When we will see the implementation about this one, we will see that our circuit is in open state, and there is some time till when it is going to be in open state. For example, when there is any problem, and now our circuit is in open state, what will be the process to reset it to the closed state? So there will be some time, right? So let's say 2 minute time. In the next 2 minute time, if we are getting the 100 requests, out of 100 requests, it is going to pick the 5 random requests, and it is going to call the third party service. It is going to call this M1 method and going to check whether it is responding properly or not. If it is responding properly, it is going to keep the state under half open, and if it is in half open state, so the number of requests that it was picking, it will be higher now. For example, and from 100 requests, it is now going to pick 20 requests and going to see that are this method is functioning properly or not. If it is functioning properly and success response we are getting, it is again going to be in the closed state. So now we have again come to the closed state. All the requests will be served to this M1 method here, right? So this is the life cycle of the circuit breaker: closed state, open state, half open state, and this closed state again. Advantage we are getting out of this circuit breaker. So first and foremost, that is, we are getting the reliability, we are getting the proper handling of the error. That is the next point, and preventing the cascading failure that I was talking about. We have S1, S2, S3. Any error that is coming here on the S2, it is not going to burst to this one, but we are properly handling that, gracefully handling that, so we can pass the proper message to the client. So that's all about the theory in circuit breaker. Now coming to the last one, that is how to implement this one. There are different libraries available out there that we can use. So first and most popular is the Netflix Hystrix that we have. But from some time, this has been pushed to the maintenance mode. There are no changes that are coming, new feature coming into Netflix Hystrix. So Spring Boot team has come up with its own circuit breaker, Spring Cloud circuit breaker that we have, and under that it is going to support many circuit breaker libraries. The way that we have Netflix Hystrix, we also have Resilience 4J, which is being very popular nowadays here. So I have implemented both of these, Netflix Hystrix as well as Resilience 4J. Let me show you that. So this is the channel that you have here. So you come here and search for the Hystrix, you will get the playlist. Yeah, first playlist is here that we have, and the second one should be here. Yeah, about Hystrix, I have these two videos, this Netflix Hystrix circuit breaker and Hystrix circuit breaker. These are the two videos here, and about Resilience 4J, we have all these videos here. You can get the proper understanding about these one. What is this Resilience 4J? What is this Netflix Hystrix and how to implement that? I'm going to give the direct link in the description box. You can directly check out this. So next we are going to see about the service registry and discovery. This is very important. That's all about this video. I'm going to repeat the last line of the video, which is most obvious. If you found the content useful, please don't forget to like, share, subscribe the channel, and press the bell icon so that we get notification about every upload on the channel. I'll see you in the next video. Till then, take care, stay safe, bye bye.